I got requested a lot to discuss the GSM symbolic paper from Apple, where they're discussing whether or not models can't reason. And they're making the strong claim that they can't, because their performance drops a lot when you change seemingly unimportant details of the question, suggesting that they're overfitting and that they're just memorizing and pattern matching and not actually reasoning. I read it very carefully. I read it in context of other research as well. And let's say I'm not impressed at all by this paper. I'm actually quite shocked almost by the quality of this paper. I find it pretty bad, and it's getting a lot of attention, even though if you read it carefully and you think about the conclusions they're making based on the data they provide, and also them ignoring previous research done on the subject, it's pretty astonishing how a paper like this can be so influential. I'm open to see contradictory evidence. This is what research is about. But not like this. This is not good science. So let's dive into it. They give models the GSM-8K, which is a dataset with grade school math questions. So they're not very hard. The GSM-8K is something that's widely available on the web. So the probability that models have seen it before and that they've had the possibility to memorize it is quite high. So they're testing basically two things in this paper. The first one is that they have a token bias, just changing tokens that have nothing to do with the math question itself, like changing the name of a person, or changing the numbers from 5 to 7, but not changing the logic of the question, deteriorates their performance. That's the first claim they make. The second claim they make is that as they increase the complexity of the question, their performance drops more than they would expect. So that's the second part. So let's go through this. Here you can see a very simple example of how they did it. When Sophie watches her nephew, she gets out a variety of toys for him. The bag of building blocks has 31 blocks in it, blah, blah, blah. So they can change the name, they can change the family. So instead of Sophie, it's now Boris, and from nephew to niece. You can see how this shouldn't change the answer to the question, if you understand it correctly. This is a good setup to test whether or not they are memorizing data. But memorization and generalization do not exclude each other. This is an important thing to understand. Actually, this is a common phenomenon seen in large neural networks, is that they can overfit the data while also generalizing to new data. It's called benign overfitting. It's a quite surprising finding. You can have a data set with a lot of noise in it, and then the model overfits on it, so it starts to memorize the noise. But then when you give it another question outside of this data, it still generalizes. So some reason is both memorizing and reasoning at the same time. The idea is actually really simple. If you have a small neural network, then you can memorize the data with all the neurons in your network. Your network is full. So when you want to go to a network that generalizes, you have to remove all the connections you made to memorize and then change it to something that generalizes. So you have to actually increase the loss, because once you destroy all these connections, you are not able to perform well anymore. So you increase the loss in order to make a generalization structure that has a lower overall loss. So you have to sacrifice loss in order to get to a better state. So basically, memorization is stuck in a local minima, and generalization is the lower minima, or maybe a global minima. So in order to get out of the local minima, you have to get up in loss and go to the global minima. And this can be quite hard. Models can get stuck in these local minima. Now, what happens when you make the model bigger is part of the network is for memorization. But you have so much capacity that you can use the other part of the network to reason. You don't have to destroy the older memorization structure. You can just leave it intact and use the other part of the network to try out structures to generalize without sacrificing loss. So this minima disappears. Now, it's not completely accurate to say that the minima just flattens. It actually has to do with the dimensionality. When you have higher dimensionality, local minima are quite rare. It's hard to have a local minima in a high dimension, because every dimension has the possibility of sloping down, making a local minima a saddle point instead of a local minima. I have a video coming up on this that illustrates this in 3D to show you exactly what I mean, because I think that's a very key thing to understand why these big neural networks are able to generalize and don't overfit. And actually, interestingly, that's in line with this paper. They show that bigger networks overfit less and that they generalize more. Even though they're not trying to prove this, they do prove this. And they don't mention it, but the data of them does show it. That's quite funny. So they're discussing some previous work, some previous papers. all in line with their hypothesis, of course, supporting the idea that they're pattern matchers, but they are ignoring the body of evidence showing that they do generalize, and also ignoring a lot of the mechanistic interpretability papers for example, entropic, showing that models create internal structures that are logically representing mathematical operations. They actually can see that in the neurons. They're building some kind of structure that's able to do summation, for example, or multiplication or stuff like that. So we can look into these models and actually see that they are making some kind of abstractions and some kind of reasoning. So they are capable of it. And I'm not saying that today's models are most efficient at reasoning. If you watch my previous video or the video that will be out on Friday, it will be quite clear to you that the current models are not the best at generalization outside of distribution and reasoning, but they are good intuitive thinkers. They're good system one thinkers. And if you give them a lot of data, then just like humans, at some point we will find some kind of generalization. At some point we will be able to do these kinds of questions, maybe even do math. But you can imagine how much math does a human have to see before it's able to do it intuitively. It's going to take quite a long time. Normally, we use some kind of logic to deal with math, and otherwise, we're going to be quite limited in our capabilities, which these models are. That's why O1 and the line of O1 models is going to be very important for this. So they made their own data set, and they're discussing some other variations on the data set. And here they mention another paper from the same year. What I don't like about this is that this paper is the same, but with a different conclusion. And they did not discuss the results of this paper and their related work section. I'm just going to show this paper real quick. So what they did in this paper, instead of changing certain variables like the name or the number, they had human annotators looked at three examples from the GSM-8K, and they made a novel problem from this on the same difficulty level. So look at this graph. This graph shows the similarity between the GSM-1K, which is the new dataset, with the GSM-8K, which is the old dataset. And this line is where they're exactly the same. They have the same performance on both datasets. So if these models are not overfitting on the data, and they're actually generalizing, then we expect them to be on this line. If they're under this line, it means that they are memorizing the GSM-8K. So what you can see is that the big models like GPT-4 and Gemini are on this line, so they're not overfitting, while smaller models do overfit, and smaller models do see a drop in accuracy. Basically saying, bigger models generalize better, which is in line with what I just explained. And in this paper, they also mention that a model that overfits does not mean that it's poor at reasoning, merely that it's not as good as the benchmark might say, but they can still be capable of reasoning and solving novel problems. So this is so interesting. This other paper is showing completely the opposite conclusion of the Apple paper. And you might think, why do these two papers that both alter the dataset so that it's uncontaminated, why do they show such different conclusions? Is it that they have very different results? Here's the interesting thing. No, they do not have different results. This line that I just showed you is not very different from the results of the Apple paper. But the Apple paper selectively chooses results in order to make their conclusion. I'll show exactly this. So one of the first things they show is this plot. The dotted vertical line is the score on the GSM-8K. And then on the Apple dataset, this is the blue line. First thing is that the accuracy of a lot of these models drops with this new dataset, suggesting overfitting. But here's the thing. Just like we saw in the previous paper, the bigger models don't. And when we look at this graph, GPT-4 actually performs slightly better on this new dataset. And that's probably just by chance, but it's to say that GPT-4 is not performing worse on this altered dataset. So bigger models still generalize. Otherwise they would show a drop. And what do they make of this? Well, they kind of sweep over this. They don't really address this. They just ignore this fact that the bigger models perform better. They're just focusing on the smaller models and saying they are overfitting. So all models are overfitting. And then they're noticing the variance and they're saying, well, we made some different variations on one question, and one time the model gets it right and the other time it doesn't get it right, even though we only changed the name of the family member, for example. So this variance in the results is weird. Why do we get this variance? This variance must mean that models are focusing on the wrong things. Well, we can't say that, because you can ask a model the same question, exactly the same question, don't even change the family member, and you will get a different result. If you ask the same question a lot of times, you get a different result. Why? Because these models are based on probability. So they're going to answer these questions based on this probability. They might say an answer is 90% probable, means if you ask it 10 times, one of these times, it's going to get it wrong. And this variation is not due to any overfitting. This variation is just because of the the way models are implemented, right? We can make them so that they always give the highest likely answer. We can set the temperature to zero, but we want them to be somewhat creative, so we don't. This is just a hyperparameter choice. It has nothing to do with overfitting. And now we go on to the second claim. And the second claim is that when you have more reasoning steps, the models perform worse. So how do they do this? See, they're going to subtract a clause, they're going to add a clause, and they're going to add two clauses. So you have GSM symbolic M1, means minus one clause, P1 with a clause, and P2 with two clauses extra. So you can see it here. To make a call from a phone booth, you must pay $0.6 for each minute of your call. After 10 minutes, that price drops to 0.5 per minute. How much would a 16-minute call cost? So you can see, we can remove this clause of after 10 minutes, that price would drop to 50 cents per minute. We can add a clause. After 25 minutes from the start of the call, the price drops even more to 0.3 euros per minute. Or we can add two clauses. So we can make the problem longer. And we would expect the model to perform worse. But what they are saying is we would expect it to be linear. That is something I doubt. I mean, what is the evidence for that? Is that the case with humans? Will their performance drop linearly or will it drop exponentially, for example? That's not very clear. That's just an assumption they're making. Now we look at this and what we see with a small model like a Gemma 29B, it drops. You can see that if you add a clause, it gets lower. We add a clause, it gets even lower. And we add another clause, it gets really low. So let's say it's increasing more than linearly, which is their claim. But now again, they're only looking at the small models. Because now look at the GPT-4 model. Look at the O1 model. Are they increasing super linearly? No, not at all, actually. You can see that with zero clauses to one clause to three clause, they're all the same. GPT-4 drops only with the third added clause. Before that, it stays the same. So their conclusion that it's dropping super linearly is only true for the smaller models. And they're ignoring the bigger models again. It's quite logical that more reasoning steps causes model to drop in performance. But why does it stay the same for the GPT-4 model? It seems like they can do very well under X amount of reasoning steps, and once it exceeds this, they get worse. This is quite logical if you look at the architecture. Because if you look at the architecture, you can see it's a feedforward neural network. And let's say this feedforward neural network can fit in four reasoning steps. You go to the first part of the network, you do one reasoning step, you go to second reasoning step, etc. Now, in order to do eight reasoning steps, you have to loop back and go through the whole network again. If you want to do infinite reasoning steps, you have to have an infinite loop. Models do this, in a sense. These models are autoregressive, meaning that they take their output and put it in their input into the next run. So they have some kind of looping effect. But in order to actually use this effectively, this loop, they need to be able to use chain of thought effectively. They need to be able to utilize the reasoning in their output for the next input. That's something they're not trained to do this effectively. O1 models are trained to do this effectively, but GPT-4 models are not. That's why we see this gap. That's why they're staying around this area, because they can deal with three reasoning steps easily, because it's all within their neural network. When it exceeds this, they need some kind of recursive structure in order to do it effectively. And O1 Mini has this recursive structure, but this is just Mini, and I think that Preview might be able to handle this better. But they didn't include Preview in these graphs, so we can't know for sure. But I think it's reasonable to expect that this drop over more reasoning steps is gonna disappear, as these Preview models are able to do this recursive structure better and able to do reasoning steps better. But a decrease in performance is expected if the complexity of the problem increases. This is the same with humans. This is just a logical consequence of complexity. But their conclusion is totally wrong. The conclusion that it drops superlinearly is not true. The drop is only superlinear for smaller models, not for bigger models. Just like the previous conclusion. Then the last thing they do, they actually do another thing. And that's that they add a clause that looks important but isn't actually important. For example, Oliver picks 44 kiwis on Friday. Then he picks 58 kiwis on Saturday. On Sunday, he picks the double number of kiwis he did on Friday. But five of them were a bit smaller than average. How many kiwis does Oliver have? But five of them were a bit smaller than average. That is not needed to solve this question, of course. For some reason, these models trip over this and they start trying to include this in the question. It's not very weird that they do this. I think humans would do this as well. If you got a question like this that's relatively straightforward, so you recognize it as some grade school question, and you see a random clause in there, while all other parts are relevant, you might mistake this for something relevant too. Now, if your logic is good and you're actually critically thinking, then you will notice that that's not needed, but it's not weird to see a drop-off. I think if you do this with humans, they will have a drop-off too. It's just expected. You can see that the O1 preview model is tripped up the least by this. You can see that the reasoning is helping them critically think and select the right things to focus on. Now, they also noticed something interesting. Some of these models like Gemma 2b, like these small models, they perform a lot better when you include this random clause. You can see that they perform very bad, like 12%, 8%, and 48% when we add this random clause. Now, isn't that very weird? Why would their accuracy improve from adding a nonsensical clause? They don't give an explanation with this. Maybe it's just by chance. I think there can be an explanation, and that's that models are able to use tokens to reason. Like I said, it's an autoregressive model. They take their output and use it as an input. So if you have more tokens, even if these tokens don't make any sense, that means that this recursive structure can repeat for every token that you added. So it gives it more computational power. This is just speculation. Here is their conclusion. So the conclusion is that they are pattern matching and they're not truly reasoning, and that this paper showed this. Okay, to make a paper with claims like these that are based on nothing, what did they actually show? They showed that with an uncontaminated dataset, smaller models drop in accuracy, while bigger models almost don't drop at all. They conclude that this is proving memorization. My conclusion from this would be that smaller models are showing some dependency on overfitting on these benchmarks, while bigger models are able to generalize more. Their reasoning is flawed because of two reasons. First, you could not make this statement based on a drop in performance. You would need it to go to zero, not just a drop of a couple percent. And secondly, this drop is not even there for bigger models. So it's only for smaller models that they're memorizing. And the second claim, that when you increase the complexity, the models perform a lot worse than you would expect, is only true for smaller models again. And what to expect is also something subjective. Who says that adding an extra reasoning step causes linear increase in error rate? Is this true for humans? Is this where they're getting their assumption from? I don't know. But it's not true for bigger models again. Bigger models show a sublinear decrease in error. And then they show that adding a random clause causes the model to trip up. But again, only smaller models. And the bigger the model, the better you get at not tripping up over it. The preview model, the ones that can reason, get the best score, showing that these reasoning models are getting pretty good at selecting the right information. So this Apple paper, it's not showing anything. And they're ignoring a lot of previous results from research. They're ignoring interpretability research. They're ignoring the previous benchmark that was done before this. And they're making claims based on their own results, which is selectively done on a small part of their results. And they make conclusions that are not valid. There's just so much on this paper that's just not good. It's quite disappointing. The fact that people refer to this paper and that they use this paper as evidence is showing that people are not critically evaluating these papers.